Thank you for the build-up. I have the pleasure to introduce to you Lior. Lior, what nationality you are?
I think Israeli.
What do you mean you think? What nationality you are?
Israeli. And I don't know if it's an interview. It's basically an end-of-day stand-up for you guys.
That's if we are lucky.
Yes.
Sometimes, you know, you try to do stand-up and you come out very pathetic.
That happened to me last time when I was you on stage, Yossi.
No, it was great. So, Lior, how old are you, can I ask? You don't have to answer any question you don't want to answer.
I'm 40.
40. Last time I interviewed you 2 weeks, 2 months ago, you were 39.
All of those gray hairs are since then, yes. Past 40 recently.
Yeah, when is your birthday?
March 16.
March 16. 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. How is it to feel so old?
It feels great. It's been a very long year. It feels like the last 15 months have been pretty long. So
yeah, that's true. We will come to it. So you were born 40 years ago where?
Haifa, Israel.
Haifa, Israel. And where did you learn in Haifa, Israel?
In a wonderful institute called the Technion.
The Technion. And you finished the Technion. You went to the army or you were in the army before the Technion?
Both. I've finished my master degree doing the military.
Uh-huh, good. And can I ask you where you were in the military?
In some yet to be named intelligence unit.
Yet to be named. So it's not 8200?
No.
Can you tell us, it has a number, this unit?
It does.
So I know you cannot tell us the number, but maybe you can select two numbers that the sum of them is the number of the unit?
The sum is 14.
The sum of the digit. Okay.
Yes.
So you were in the army, in the unit. What have you done after you finished the army?
Well, the plan was to go and study a PhD in Stanford. But somewhere along the route, I've moved to the dark side and decided to do an MBA at Stanford. So I moved to the States to learn my business school degree.
Uh-huh. And what your parents said when you went?
They were very disappointed. My Polish mom, that is really Iraqi, always accepted me to do a PhD. So she's still waiting for that to happen.
Yeah. So your Polish mother expected you to do... By the way, in order that you will know, Jewish mother... Is not an ethnic, is not a gender, it's a state of mind. You can be very well a male Jewish mother. If you don't believe, ask my sons. So she wanted you, of course, to do a doctorate.
That was the plan.
And this is why you came to the United States. Mm-hmm. And you disappointed, like most of us, you disappointed your mother.
Exactly, like most of us.
Yeah, it happened to all of us. You know, my mother... Try to motivate me. She always asked me why Ilan is my cousin, who was the son of her daughter, who happened to become later in life the president of Weizmann Institute. You understand? This was the bar. She said, why Yaffa, his sister, has a son who is a genius, and I have a son who is an idiot. All my life she complained that I'm idiot. And... at one point, by the way, she told me, I will explain to you why all your cousins are smart, you are an idiot, because they are not contaminated with the genes of your father. So your mother sent you to do...
The plan was to get a PhD, and then, like all of us, I got attracted to technology and sort of unleashed the geek on me and had a wonderful career at Google.
Yeah, you went to Google. How many years ago?
In almost 10 years now.
You know, by the way, these are all true stories. I want you to know. I spoke once with Jenya, the mother of Sergei. And I asked her, Jenya, what do you say that Sergei in order to make this little money-making machine, gave up his doctorate in Stanford. You know that he never finished. So he told me, Yossi, maybe you can influence him because I cannot influence him. It's very bad he didn't finish the doctorate. She said, Google Schmoogle, Sergei must finish his PhD and he must write a thesis and protect it, and honorary doctorate is out of the question, you know, so you have...
So along those lines, it wasn't quite Google Schmoogle, but along the line was Otto Schmoto, the PhD desire is still there.
Still, so one day you are going to finish your PhD.
That's the plan, yeah.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, just need to launch some self-driving stuff before.
Yeah. Okay, so you went to Google how many years ago it was?
10 years ago, and had the pleasure of doing both building software platforms with Google Maps and learning the wonderful
world. You went to do Google Maps. I remember mm-hmm. that you told me with blinking eyes, I think, in Jackson Hole many number of years ago that you are doing maps. This was at what year?
I'm sorry?
What year?
This was from 2006 to 2011.
2006 to 2011. And then you had a very interesting career change before Otto Schmoto. From the maps, they made you?
I led business and product for Motorola. So learned the wonderful world of creating hardware and actual physical machines.
Why did they give you this kind of responsibility, a kid from Haifa?
In the hardware business, I think we all understand really in the end of the day, it's about the product and the service and the software strategy. So when we bought Motorola, there was a desire to really rethink mobile computing and rethink how can we actually build services and really sort of reinvent
the mobile. And you were not afraid to bet your future on very dubious thing, which is called smart telephones?
The best opportunities come when you actually lean in and take risks and go to something you actually haven't done before.
So you were in Motorola until when?
2015.
2015. And then in 2015, you decided that enough is enough.
I really felt an urge to do something that can profoundly help society. And really, in the end of the day, there's nothing more profound, I think, that we as technologists can do in the next decades than teach computers how to drive. So I've combined my software skills, my hardware skills, and really sort of created a platform with Otto to really disrupt and really accelerate that future. You know, that future of self-driving cars, it's sort of I view it as a cure for cancer.
I told you this is the cure of cancer?
So well, as technologies, we just look at the world around us and there are just so many pain points, over millions of deaths every year, pollution, half of the pollution in the air is coming from cars and trucks. Our cities are hostage and basically uses ginormous parking lots.
I think you decided you wanted to do a self-driving car because you wanted to play, and now we are doing reverse engineering to invent the social mission of it. You just wanted to have fun. This is my feeling.
Both. We wanted to have fun and we wanted to change society.
Okay, so you left in 2015 mm-hmm. and you started to work on this auto concept. And you told me, by the way, speaking about saving society, excuse me for repeating the story that some of you heard it this morning. I think this is a side comment. You know, I think you guys are not focusing on the real issue. You know, I think I have a much more ambitious idea. I don't know how to materialize it yet, but this is only an engineering problem. I think the issue is not autonomous cars, I think the issue is autonomous bladders, you know, because when you wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning, so I want to create a bladder, you know, you push here, the bladder goes to the John, and then it comes back, and you don't have to get off. What do you think about it?
Love it.
You love it. So
I'm going to put some engineers on it.
Once you finish...
One step at a time.
Yeah.
So...
And I know that since you were a kid, your dream was in the beginning self-driving coconut. No?
One by one. The most popular request we're getting is actually self-driving RVs. People just want to get into RV, press a button, and wake up in a new national park. You'll be amazed by how many emails and actually letters we got from people asking for self-driving RVs. So I think we're going to do trucks, cars, RVs, and then maybe the coconut.
Yeah, you can always develop a version when you put your mother-in-law in the RV. This can be a great market.
I'll
think about
it.
I'll
mention it when she's coming here next week.
What your mother-in-law said when you left Google?
She didn't quite understand what this whole serving truck is. And it took me a while to convince her.
And she was convinced?
Not yet. She's coming in 2-3 months and I'm going to give her a ride and hopefully that will help. But she doesn't quite fully get it yet, but one step at a time.
I want to see that you convince your mother-in-law to go in a self-driving car and you are not in the car.
So let's
I'm sure she will think this is the ultimate solution.
Let's talk a bit about...
The final solution.
Should we talk... They can go pretty far. Should we talk a bit about trucks?
We will come to it.
Okay, I'm waiting.
We are more interested in your pathetic career, you know.
Happy to share that.
Then about the car. You know, autonomous car now, it's
common.
Common. Yeah, it's not a big deal
everyday
anymore.
Everyday
sighting. Yeah. So you left in the... by the way, I have to tell you another story about mother-in-law. I interviewed Joe Lieberman. Joe Lieberman was nominated to be vice president of United States when Al Gore was nominated to be president. Unfortunately, he didn't win. And I interviewed him. I told him what your wife said when you didn't win to be the vice president of United States. He said, my wife was not excited. She told me, Joe, in our home, you always will be the vice president. And then I asked him, Joe, what your mother-in-law, at least your mother-in-law confirmed you, you know, approved it, embraced you when you were elected to be when you were nominated to be vice president. He said, my mother-in-law approved me. Confirmed me, she said, the first phone call I got was for my mother-in-law, and she said, Joe, a temporary job again? Okay, so far for your mother-in-law, she's coming, you put her in an autonomous truck.
Yeah.
And what destination you will give the autonomous truck?
TBD, we need to choose carefully a highway and a destination on this
one. Yeah, okay.
But we're operating now in multiple states across the US, and we engage with a lot of commercial shippers.
Any route close to the rim of the Grand Canyon?
Not at all, as far as possible from that.
Okay. So 2015, you started to work on the autonomous truck.
Yeah, we didn't know anything about trucks, and we didn't know if anybody would actually join us to this crazy adventure, because who wanna work on trucks, and those are just things that sort of move in the background and highways.
Why
and
truck?
Sort of
why not Porsche or Lamborghini? Why truck?
Because when we actually looked at the problem, we've realized that the most easy problem to solve is the highways, and that's where also the biggest pain point is. If you actually want to solve fatalities on the road, 87% of the deaths are happening on the highway.
87%.
Of deaths today are happening on the highway, but on the same time...
You know that 73% of numbers which are cited in such
conversation
are invented on the stop, on the spot.
Good, so I can quote some more along those lines.
Okay, 87%.
It's the biggest pain point, and yet probably the most simple environment to solve because it's just simpler to drive on the highway. We don't have to exert as much mental energy. We don't have pedestrian, bikes, crosswalks, lights. So it's a much easier problem to solve.
This is the low-hanging fruit.
And if you actually look at trucks, although they're only moving 1% of miles in the U.S. are moving on trucks, they're actually responsible, 1% of vehicles are trucks. That's responsible for 6% of the miles. Those 6% of miles are responsible for 12% of the accidents. And then 12% of accidents, because there's usually two passenger cars involved in every truck accident, are responsible for 24%, or almost a quarter of the deaths. So you're actually looking at something, we only have a few millions of those. In an easy problem to solve, or easier, it's not easy, and we can actually eliminate a quarter of those unnecessary deaths.
So you started, it was a year...
January 2016. Yeah.
You see, I remember. So January you started, March is your birthday. Okay. So January 16, and then what happened... By the way, I know that you privileged us by preparing some small video.
We started really moving with urgency on the problem, and the entire mindset was, let's actually approach it with urgency and try to get on the road in a safe way, and I'll talk about that in a second and how we do testing, but let's just get some stuff on the truck to allow us to start testing and understanding the problem. So we've done that in a very short...
When did you finish the testing?
Testing is still ongoing, but basically within...
When you demonstrated the concept?
We had our first demonstration in Nevada within just a few months, in May.
In May.
And then as we've done that, we've realized a lot of things. Basically, once we've sort of went out of stealth, and we had a big debate, should we actually go out of stealth or not? In the end of the day, we decided to go out of stealth to continue recruiting the team. We've realized a few things. One is great engineers want to ship. And the faster we made progress, the more engineers wanted to join because they saw we were making progress on a weekly and monthly basis, and they wanted to join and make a change. And actually, the more time people work on that problem of self-driving, the more they were attracted to an environment where they can actually feel they can ship stuff and make stuff happen and actually create some impact. So we've done that demo in Nevada in May. And then we went out of stealth, and within 3 weeks, the entire logistics industry came stopping by in our garage in San Francisco to educate us on the market and the opportunities. And what we've realized is really the opportunity alongside building that autonomous trucking technology is also build a marketplace for trucks, for freight. If you want to think about it as Uber for trucks, to really connect all of those shippers and carriers, which are very fragmented and don't really have a manual way today to even carry their freight business. So the idea then became...
Will become the autonomous U-Haul?
The idea then became, let's create a marketplace for trucks, first and foremost. Let's actually create some liquidity in the market. And once we create the liquidity, we can start automating that. And that propelled us to two things. One, if we can maybe roll the first video, and you've all seen...
Can you please roll the first video, which means there also will be a second video at least.
There will be at least another video. If we can roll the first truck video for a second. So you've all seen sort of that Budweiser route.
What is this yellow thing with the red...
That's the engage button.
It's called hit me, this button.
Hit me to go autonomous. And that's the first commercial delivery in history we've done with a commercial partner. Budweiser in Colorado for 120 miles from Colorado Springs through Denver to the destination.
I don't see a driver in there.
There is no driver.
Tell me, are you crazy? Are you sick?
Practice on that road many, many times before we felt comfortable enough of getting the driver out, and we actually had police escorting us from both sides to make sure that we're doing it in a safe manner. And we've learned a lot of things.
It's empty.
That's the plan. We had 50,000 cans of beer in the back, and actually
I know Yossi, the driver, while the car was driving, the driver was sitting in the back drinking 50,000.
He's still doing that. We have a lot of beer to drink, and Yossi, I thought maybe you can help us with that, so I actually brought you one of those beers.
You are in the wrong business. Believe me, you have to be in the show business. You will make much better career.
So half of the work was on actually doing this route. The other half was actually doing a special Budweiser branded beer. And we still have a couple of those 10,000 beer.
I want you to take this. Take it. I want you to put it in eBay and to sell it as the first beer which was driven in autonomous car. And see how much you can fetch for it.
Okay,
you will do
it? Let's do that. We'll do that.
Good.
And you can choose where the proceedings will go.
Good.
So we've learned a lot from that. We've learned both the what actually makes trucking easier. We have plenty of compute power in the back of those trucks. It's easier to actually do that on the highway. We don't have to aim for some cost curve because we can amortize the cost of those sensors over many, many miles. But we've also learned the challenges. And the opportunity was really we want to create that network of freight. And then Uber came by, and with the understanding of really we can accelerate the pace of deploying that freight network.
And this was after 8 months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, around August.
And they made you an offer you can't refuse.
Correct. We couldn't.
And how many revenues you had at that time?
We had $425 of revenue from the delivery in Colorado.
Ah, okay, because I thought you had zero revenue.
Which was still the first revenue in history from a self-driving activity, but still, yeah. Yes.
But it was not that you sold it with zero revenue.
No, never. Zero money raised, $425 revenue.
And can you share with us, you know, we are Israelis, and the most interesting question is, how big? How big was the exit?
It's sizable. There's been a bunch of numbers.
No, don't bullshit. How much did they?
It's very hard to actually put a number because a lot of it is on the future.
In the future, okay. Yes.
But I would say really what propelled us to
do. So to make them feel really the pain, if you get the maximum, how much you will get? Never mind.
I can't comment on specifics, but hopefully my mom will be proud enough that she'll forget about
that. Tell me, now we are coming, you know, the time run. Now we are coming to the most important question. So you called your mother and you told her, Mom, you see, I'm not an idiot. I didn't get a PhD, but I got, I don't know, six. Let me invent a number, you know, like $683 million. I'm just inventing it. So what your poor mother said, the truth?
She was happy for a bit, but she still asked about the PhD. So that's still on the list. So we joined Uber, really with few goals. One is really to accelerate the deployment of that Uber Freight and Uber network. Second is to accelerate and collaborate with the amazing Uber team in Pittsburgh, the pace of development on the trucks. And three is to really utilize everything we can from the Uber network to accelerate the pace of technology. So let me talk for a bit about how we're testing and how that's going.
I have a question for you. How are you testing and how it's going?
Thank you. It's going super well. So we were able to do a few things. One is we're able to really sort of grow that network, and we're already sort of in business with many, many shippers nationally about really offering them logistics service and offering them that freight service. The other thing is we're able to really accelerate the pace of technology development. If we can roll the second video for a second. And just
I promise you a second video. By the way, this is on the account of your cocktail party.
And this is just a glimpse of the resources and the ability we can actually use Uber for. So this is our test track. In Pittsburgh, and that's we haven't actually shared that video.
And you are now running the autonomous program for Uber or something like this?
Yes, and we are both cars and trucks. And this is an example of how we test those cars and also trucks, it's not in that video, on that test course. What we basically try to do is simulate everything we learn about how cars conduct in the real world from tapping into the Uber network. What are the common obstacles? What are the edge cases? What are the things that those cars actually encounter on a daily basis, and then we take all of those know-how and understanding to that test course to be able to test continuously before we actually deploy the software on the road.
And you would tell me that I will call Uber and an empty car will stand in front of me and I have to be idiot enough to go into the car and trust it?
When it's safe enough, hopefully you wouldn't be an idiot, and that's really sort of the long-term vision. We have a long way to go about doing that, but yeah, that's the goal.
Amazing. Before you go off the stage, how many people like you with mothers that want their sons to have a doctorate from Stanford we still have in Israel?
How many we have in Israel? Many
like
tens of thousands?
Tens of thousands?
Yeah, if not more.
People like you.
Well.
And Gil Golan. Gil, are you here? Gil. Gil, you are still here? Come over. come over. I need you here. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I presented to you in the morning Gil Golan, and now I present to you this young gentleman and I think tomorrow we are going to have some more Israeli brain. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed the day. Mr. Ron, thank you very much.
You
want to say some final Final word.
I'm just
final word for you. Final word for you.
Very excited about the future and being able to accelerate that, and very excited about the Israeli ecosystem. I think you guys seen that. There's tremendous innovation, specifically in the car ecosystem in Israel today, and we're looking forward to accelerate that and do many partnerships and really see the whole ecosystem mature, specifically in Israel.
Thank you. Thank you.
Last word. Just a minute. Last word of shameless Zionist propaganda, Gil.
Well, first I would like to say that I'm proud of Leo. He and Anthony did the right thing, and I think that Uber did the outstanding thing, adding this the team, the Otto team. I think we are all in the same, aiming to the same target, and this is achievable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I just want to say,
thank you very much.
Just to clarify, Lior did know ahead of time that Yossi was going to be interviewing him. He signed a letter of consent and liability waiver. I just wanted, before everyone goes and starts drinking, very heartfelt thank you to all our speakers today. Fantastic day of content. Look forward to hearing what we have tomorrow. And then thank you to all our sponsors. If you run into a speaker, make sure to grab them and say thank you. Let's drink.